Hello students, so I am here with the next topic, that is temperature compensation. So in this session we will study about temperature compensation of the strain gauge, how temperature affects the output voltage and what can we do to compensate that effect, which is due to temperature. So the output voltage which is coming because of temperature, we have to compensate that, or we have to minus the effect of temperature. So for temperature compensation of the strain gauge bridge, there are three methods or there are three ways in which we can compensate for the temperature. First one is using dummy gauge. Second method can be adjusting gauge parameters, and third is cancelling the temperature effect signal conditioner. Cancelling the temperature effect using signal conditioner, right? So in various ways we can compensate for the temperature. So one by one we'll see all these three methods. There can be other methods also, but these three methods are important. That's why we study only about these three methods, right? So let us begin with the first method, that is using dummy gauge. Using dummy gauge. How can we compensate for the temperature using dummy gauge? Right? Using dummy gauge. Okay. So in this, in the quarter bridge, in this method, in the quarter bridge, we will be using a gauge which is dummy, which does not take the load as an input, right? So let me draw the circuit first. In the quarter bridge, this is your strain gauge, which is not dummy. Means if we will apply stress, then the resistance of this strain gauge will be changed, right? Resistance of this strain gauge will be changed. And in the adjacent arm, we'll be using one dummy gauge. So let me abbreviate this as DG, dummy gauge, right? This is dummy gauge, and there is a problem of space, so I'll be drawing this circuit on this side, right? This is your strain gauge in one arm. Strain gauge. In the adjacent arm, there is a dummy gauge, DG, dummy gauge. And this is fixed resistance. This one is also fixed resistance. And we are applying excitation voltage across these two points. Excitation voltage is capital E, and we are measuring output voltage across this arm, that is V0. So in a sense, this configuration of the bridge is quarter bridge configuration. But the main problem in the quarter bridge is temperature effect. Right, so temperature affects the output in the case of quarter bridge. Okay, so if the initial resistance of the strain gauge is R and of the dummy gauge is R, so all the resistances are same and the bridge is in balanced condition. Now, the most important point is here. Strain gauge and dummy gauge, the materials are of same property. Means these are strain gauge and dummy gauge materials are same material. Both are should be of same material, and their temperature coefficient of expansion here, there, temperature coefficient of expansion should be same. Means, important point, let me write this point as material used for strain gauge and dummy gauge should be same, right? Should be same. And second important point is the temperature coefficient expansion of strain gauge and dummy gauge. Temperature coefficient of expansion of strain gauge and dummy gauge should be same, right? So if the temperature coefficient of expansion of strain gauge and dummy gauge is same and the materials of the both the gauges, strain gauge and dummy gauges, are same, then temperature induced errors will be cancelled out because we have connected strain gauge and dummy gauge in adjacent arm, right? So temperature effect will be automatically cancelled out. So this is the main concept of dummy to compensate for the temperature, right? So in a way, this is your only quarter bit. This is quarter bit. This is quarter bit, and the second gauge, which is a dummy gauge, is only temperature dependent, and temperature effect of dummy gauge and strain gauge will be cancelled out, and hence your output voltage will be temperature independent, right? So this is the main concept of dummy gauge, right? Okay, so this is all about your temperature compensation using dummy gauge, right? I forgot one point, that is the strain gauge and dummy gauge should be connected in the adjacent arm. So let me write this: dummy gauge and strain gauge should be connected in adjacent arm. These two gauges must be connected in adjacent arm so that they can compensate for the temperature, right? Now which temperature can be compensated is adjusting gauge parameters, right? So here let me clear some space first. Adjusting gauge parameters. So by adjusting some gauge parameters like gauge factor or temperature coefficient of expansion of the material, by choosing materials such that its temperature compensation, its temperature effect could be cancelled out. Right, its temperature effect could be cancelled out. So by choosing the material, we can also compensate for the temperature, right? So the temperature generated resistance is given by dr/r is the subscript delta t. dr/r in the subscript delta t is equal to sg alpha s minus alpha g, alpha s minus alpha g into delta t, alpha s minus alpha g into delta t plus sg delta t plus sg delta t. So this is temperature induced resistance in temperature induced resistance, right? Where Sg is nothing but gauge sensitivity. Sg is nothing but gauge sensitivity or gauge factor, we can say. This is gauge sensitivity. Gauge sensitivity, right? Alpha S is temperature coefficient of expansion for specimen material. For specimen material. And alpha G is equal to temperature coefficient of expansion for gauge material. For gauge material, your delta T is your temperature change, delta T is your temperature change, and delta T is your temperature change, and ST is sensitivity to temperature, sensitivity to temperature, right? So by this equation, dr by r is equal to sg alpha s minus alpha g into delta t plus st delta t, where all the terms are written here. Okay, so if we control alpha g here, if we control sg is constant, alpha s is constant, alpha g, if we choose gauge material which has temperature coefficient such that it cancels the effect of this term. It cancels the effect of this term, ST delta T. ST delta T. Delta T is the temperature which is automatically given, means delta T is something which you cannot control, right? And if you choose ST and alpha G, if you control ST, ST means sensitivity to temperature, and alpha G means temperature coefficient of expansion for gauge material. If we control alpha G and ST such that this whole term cancels out, right? Means dr by r because of temperature is zero. And how is this becoming zero? By choosing alpha G and ST, right? By choosing alpha G and ST. Let me clear some space. If we control alpha G and ST, alpha G and ST is chosen such that dr by r because of temperature becomes zero. Means you choose alpha G. If you choose alpha G such that this term becomes negative, whereas this term is exactly positive, then dr by r because of temperature will be zero. And if ST delta T is positive, ST delta T is positive, and you choose alpha G such that this term is positive. I beg your pardon. If ST delta T is positive, then you choose alpha G such that this whole term is negative, then dr by r because of temperature will be zero. Vice versa, if ST delta T is negative, then choose alpha g such that this whole term becomes exactly positive, then dr by r because of temperature will be zero. So in this manner, by controlling some parameters, temperature effect can be compensated, right? So this is your second point, adjusting gauge parameters to compensate for the temperature. Okay, now third method by which temperature effect can be compensated is using the signal conditioner. And this method is applicable for the weak stability. So first you had a quarter bridge, right? And again a half bridge came. So quarter bridge was unable to compensate for the temperature. That's why quarter bridge came, in which two strain gauges were connected, right? And for more improvement for the temperature compensation, full bridge came, in which four strain gauges were connected, right? So this method is like those methods only, okay? In which you have to use some elements which nullify the temperature effect generated by the resistance. Okay, so like half bridge and full bridge, you had quarter bridge first, in which only one strain gauge was connected. And for that purpose, to nullify for the temperature, half bridge came, for more improvement, full bridge. Okay, so half bridge and full bridge also they used for temperature compensation. Okay, temperature compensation, half bridge and full bridge were utilized for temperature compensation, right? Again, if you are not satisfied with these half bridge and full bridge, then there is another method using lead wire. Okay, using lead wire. So in this you have two lead wire methods and three lead wire. Here you have to remember that the bridge which is used for the temperature compensation is the quarter bridge, because half bridge and full bridge both are already temperature compensated. Okay, half bridge is used for temperature compensation and full bridge is also used for temperature compensation. So in most of the applications only quarter bridge is used. So the basic circuit for the strain measurement is quarter bridge. Again, half bridge and full bridge is more advanced version with temperature nullification. Okay, so two lead wire method and three lead wire method, there are two ways in which by conditioning the circuit we can compensate for the temperature. So let me draw the circuit and clear some space here to draw the circuit. Okay, so this is your two lead method and it involves quarter bridge. There is only one bridge, and the signal conditioning of the quarter bridge using two lead method is such that in the shown figure. So you just connect lead connecting one end of the strain gauge to this arm, okay, and other end of the strain gauge using this lead to another arm. Okay, so this is your two lead method. So if temperature effect is to be nullified, then these two these two wires nullify the temperature effect because these two wires are connected in the adjacent arm. Okay, in the adjacent arm. So initially, if the bridge is not balanced, if the bridge is balanced, then we know that if this is R1, this is R2. If the circuit could have been such that this is RD, gate resistance. In the case of quarter bridge, this is your R4, this is R2, this is R3, this is R3, and if the bridge is unbalanced, or let us suppose the bridge is balanced, in that condition, what equation you can write? This equation will be RD, R3 is equal to R2, R4 is equal to R2, R4. Okay? So, here you can write RG plus RL into RG plus RL into R3 is equal to RG plus RL, RG plus RL plus R4 into RL into R2, right? So these lead wires compensate for the temperature. This is your two lead wire method. The problem with this two lead method is that if the gate is at a distant place, and then you need the length of the lead more, right? If the length of the lead will be more, this causes some problems. What problems are caused if the strain gauge is at a distant place? The bridge becomes desensitive. Okay? The bridge becomes desensitive. Problem of the two lead method is problem in two lead method. First one is strain gauge becomes desensitive if the strain gauge is at a distant place. At a distant place, because then you need a lengthy lead. Okay, then you need a lengthy lead, and which in turn desensitize your strain gauge. Correct? Okay. Second problem with the two lead method is. It creates initial imbalance in the weak prone bridge. Initial imbalance in the weak prone bridge when the length of the lead is more. Okay, so this is basically two problems which is encountered in the case of two lead method. So to remove this problem, a second configuration came, which is C-lead method. This is C-lead method. Let me sketch the circuit first. C-lead method. Okay, so this is your C-lead method in which not two leads, three leads are connected, right? So one lead is connected with one end of the strain gauge. Other lead is connected to this arm R4 of the strain gauge, and one lead is connected to the power supply. Okay, excitation voltage. Excitation voltage in the other cases were connected between these two arms, right? Between these two points. Now, in this, excitation voltage is connected with the lead and again with the one end of the strain gauge. So, in the case of three lead method, one lead temperature effect is cancelled by one another lead. Okay? So, if temperature is changed, then temperature change effect is cancelled by this lead, and the temperature change of this lead is cancelled by this lead. So this is the significance of second lead. In this, the reduction in increase in desensitivity were reduced. Desensitivity is reduced. In the case of two lead method, the strain gauge was being desensitized. So that problem is reduced in the three lead method, whereas the initial imbalance in the second lead method is also improved by this three lead method. So these two problems were eliminated with the three lead method. So this is all about your temperature compensation. Okay. So these three problems in the three lead method is improved. First is problem of desensitivity. Problem of desensitivity is reduced. Problem of initial imbalance is reduced, and reduction of error due to temperature change in lead wires is reduced. Now if you have a strain gauge and one shunt resistance is connected, a resistance in the parallel of the strain gauge is connected, then how will you calculate strain in that case? In that case, let me show this. So equivalent resistance, if one resistance is connected in parallel, then equivalent resistance will be Rg into RSS divided by Rg plus RSS divided by Rg plus RSS. This is your equivalent resistance. Okay. So change in resistance will be delta R will be Rg minus Rg RSS divided by Rg plus RSS. Let me simplify this. This will be Rg square minus Rg RSS plus Rg plus into RSS minus Rg into RSS divided by Rg plus RSS divided by Rg plus RSS. Okay. So Rg RSS will be cancelled out with each other. So it will be equal to Rg square divided by Rg plus RSS. Sorry, Rg plus RSS. Now, delta R by Rg will be equal to, some space is needed here. So, take Rg common from this side. So, delta R divided by Rg will be equal to Rg divided by Rg plus RSS. And this is your epsilon. Okay. This is your epsilon. Delta R upon Rg is equal to Rg upon Rg plus RSS. Okay? And we know that delta R upon R in terms of epsilon, in terms of epsilon, what will be this value? Let me write this. Delta R upon R is nothing but gauge factor into epsilon. Okay? Gauge factor into epsilon. So, your RC divided by RB plus RSS is equal to gauge factor into epsilon. From here, epsilon will be equal to RG divided by gauge factor into RG plus RSS. Epsilon strain can be calculated in this manner. If you have m active gauges, if n active gauges are connected, in that case your epsilon will be RB divided by n into gauge factor into RB plus RSS. So these formulas you need to remember, and sometimes numerical is asked from these two formulas. If only one active gauge is connected, then your epsilon will be RG upon gauge factor into RG plus RSS. If n active gauge is connected, then just multiply with n in the denominator. Okay, so this is your strain calculation if some resistance is connected of resistance RSS. Value of the resistance is RSS in the shunt or in parallel. Then epsilon is calculated in this manner. Okay. Now, two more small topics here. If the direction of the strain is unknown, then to connect the strain gauge in the maximum strain direction, we have to use a Rosset gauge. Okay. If direction of the strain is unknown, then Rosset gauge is connected in multiple directions. This is your note. Okay, this is a point on which some objective questions can be asked. Now, there is another method, Poisson's method, to place strain gauge. This is also an important point. Poisson's method, how in this case strain gauges are connected. Okay, so if you have one pair of the strain gauge, so if one pair is like this, if one strain gauge is like this, other will be this. Means angle between the strain gauges will be at 90 degrees. Okay. One pair means two gauges, and the two gauges will be connected at 90 degrees. This is Poisson's method to place the strain gauge. If you have two pair means four strain gauges, then one spin gauge is like this, second one is this, third one will be this, and fourth one will be this. Okay, all the strain gauges will be at 90 degree with each other. So if you have one pair, both the strain gauges will be at 90 degree. If you have two pairs, then all the four strain gauges will be at 90 degree. This is Poisson's method to place the strain gauge. So in this case, the formula to calculate this output will be two pairs. Two pair means, so one pair means two strain gauges. So it will be some half bridge. Two strain gauge means half bridge. Half bridge, in the case of half bridge, output voltage was 1 by 2 E into gauge factor into epsilon. Gauge factor into epsilon. If the strain gauges were not placed in the Poisson, based on the Poisson's method. This is your simple half bridge, right? This is your simple half bridge. In that case, output voltage we calculated was V0 is equal to 1 by 2 into E into gauge factor into epsilon. That is correct. Okay. So if one pair is connected, then in this case V0 will be E by 4. E by 4 gauge factor into epsilon into mu plus 1. Gauge factor into epsilon into mu plus 1. Okay. This is your one pair. If one pair is connected. Okay. If two pair is connected, in this case, output voltage will be E by 2 gauge factor into epsilon into mu plus 1, where mu is Poisson's ratio. Here mu is Poisson's ratio. Mu is Poisson's ratio. Okay, so by Poisson's method, if you have to calculate output voltage, then don't misunderstood by the half bridge. Two bridges means half bridge? No. If the strain gauges are connected in the Poisson's method, then the output voltage will be V0 is equal to E by 2 gauge factor into epsilon into mu